going up together.
We're going up together.
We're going up to conquer.
In the name of the Lord.
Hey, we are going.
We are going up.
We're going up together.
We're going up together.
We're going up to conquer. In the name.
In the name.
So don't talk,
no, no,
no, don't talk defeat to me,
don't talk defeat to me,
cause I'm a child of God,
yeah. And I've got the victory,
oh, 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 don't talk,
no, no,
hey, don't talk defeat to me,
don't talk defeat to me,
cause I'm a child of God.
Of the Bible. Josiah. This is Josiah.
Heyo!
Josiah became king of Israel when he was only 8 years old.
Yep.
Now the country of Israel had a very long line of kings who did many bad things, including Josiah's father and grandfather. These kings did not follow after God, and they ignored his commandments and his law. But when Josiah became king, he did what God wanted him to and followed the example of King David.
Yeah!
18 years after Josiah became king, he sent one of his court secretary, Shaphan, to God's temple.
Thank you.
Many of the kings before Josiah did not take good care of God's house, so it was in need of repair.
Hmm.
While they're in the temple, Hilkiah, the high priest, said to Shaphan,
Hey!
I have found the book of the law in the Lord's temple. So Shaphan took the scroll back to King Josiah and read it to him. When Josiah heard what was in the book, he was greatly upset.
Oh, no!
Because the people of Israel were not doing the things that God asked them to do, and Josiah knew that God must be angry with Israel for not obeying his commandments. Josiah gathered together all the people of Israel to the temple and read the entire book of the covenant to them. That very day, Josiah and all the people promised that they would obey all of what God commanded with all their hearts and souls. Josiah went on to help Israel become a people fully committed to God. He tore down all the other temples and the idols that they had set up. He got rid of all the people who were doing bad things all throughout Israel. And he did all that was commanded in God's book. Never before had there been a king like Josiah who turned to the Lord with all his heart and soul and strength, obeying all the laws of Moses. And there has never been a king like him since.
Hi, my name is Jemiah, and I'm an usher at Beth-El. I would like to give Pastor Beale a farewell. I hope you enjoy your new church, and we will miss you.
Hallelujah. So we're going to sing this song. And it says, exceedingly, abundantly, above all you could ask or think, it's according to the power that worketh in you, you, God is able to do just what he said he would do, yeah, and he's going to fulfill every promise to you, so don't you dare give up on God, 'cause he won't give up on you. He's able. Anybody know it today? Oh. Oh, can bring you to it. Oh, I know he'll bring you out. Don't you worry. Don't you fret. Oh, God, I serve. Oh, he's never found me yet.
Sabbath to you all. Right now what we're going to do is we're just going to take a little bit of our time to just talk to God. And especially at this point of the year, I want to focus this conversation with God on our mothers, on the mothers of Beth-El. You know, Beth-El has been very blessed and fortunate to have some very loving, some very caring mothers. So I'll invite you all to just bow your heads and close your eyes with me as we seek our God in prayer. Our dear, kind, and merciful Father God, we just want to thank you for everything that you have done for us, Father God. We thank you for giving us this life, allowing us to live another day, Father God. And we understand that it is not that because we are better than those that were not able to see the end of the week, Father God. We understand that we're in the midst of a pandemic. There's so many diseases, so many things going around. People are just to see another day is a blessing, God. So we do not take it for granted. Father God, at this time, I just want to thank you for the mothers of Beth-El, Father God. Without them, where would we be? And without you, where would they be, Father God? We thank you for the love and for the care and for the nurturing spirit that you've ingrained in their hearts, Father God. I pray that you just allow that love to persist, Father God. Father God, we pray that your love can be exhibited through them, through those vessels, Father God. We pray that you just continue to bless them in a very, very special way. Thank you for all that they've done in our lives. Thank you for the sacrifices that they've made, Father God. I pray that you just continue to allow them to be a light, allow them to be a vessel, Father God. I pray that you just continue to be that hedge of protection around them, Father God. And as we're celebrating Mother's Day, I pray that you just be a mother to the motherless, Father God. I pray that you just bless those. Father God, I pray that you just be a mother. Bless our mothers. Father God, I pray that you just be with us all to this end. Father God, bless the man who is going to break the bread of life for us on this afternoon. Father God, I pray that you just speak to us in a way that we've never been spoken to before so that we may learn something new about you. Father God, your work has to be done. So I pray that you just fill us with the Holy Spirit so that we may continue to do your work, Father God. I pray that you just move all ego, all pride to the side and allow your spirit to do the work that it has to do. Pray that you be with us all to this end. In your name we pray. Amen. God bless you.
Happy Sabbath, church. Happy Sabbath, Pastor Brewer. Just wanted to pause and thank you for your leadership. You were greatly appreciated here at Beth-El Seventh-day Adventist Church in Jersey City. Know that you will be missed. From the jump, you came in and you participated in our education day. You were totally active in Sabbath school, leading out and bringing rigorous questions, allowing us to have good conversations. You also took a passion towards our upper room prayer experience, bringing a word and bringing a joyful conversation to prayer. And we just want to say thank you. We want to bless you as you move on to a new journey and a new direction with the Lord. We pray that you continue to speak like Aaron, that you continue to be bold like Joshua, and that you continue to preach like Jesus. Know that you are in our prayers. Know that you will always be considered family, and know that you are loved by all of us here at Beth-El. Stay blessed. Stay in touch. See you soon. God bless.
Happy Sabbath, everybody. We're so happy that you have chosen to worship with us here at the Beth-El Seventh-day Adventist Church. We exist to love God, love people, and show people God's love. Now, this weekend is especially significant and important and exciting because this weekend, all across this country, people will be celebrating mothers for Mother's Day on this coming Sunday. And we at Beth-El also are celebrating our mothers. We have gifts for all of our mothers that we're giving out this afternoon at our church building location. But even beyond that, I want to challenge us and remind us, Mother's Day is not just a time to thank your mother because she has given you life, and thank the significant women in the family, grandmothers, et cetera, because they are life givers. But mothers are so much more than just givers of life. Mothers also are the ones who we often come to wipe the tears from our eyes when we are saddened and hurt and depressed and downtrodden. And they're the ones who give us encouragement to keep on when we feel like we can't continue. They are often the ones that we go to for every kind of experience in life. They celebrate with us when we're up. They encourage us when we're down. And mothers aren't just for us, especially in the Black community, aren't just the one who gave us life, but there are often church mothers and other significant individuals who have impacted our life in a motherly way. I have a number of mothers since I've been away from my mother here in North Jersey. I've had a number of women who have filled a void, a gap for me, and stood in the gap for me here. And indeed, we are blessed as a people to have so many individuals who have done that for each and every one of us. I want to encourage you on tomorrow and hopefully beyond tomorrow. We should do it more often, but I want to encourage you to make sure you reach out, do something special, make sure that you spend some time appreciating the mother and mother figures in your life for this Mother's Day. And one other thing I want to say about Mother's Day, this is often a time for some individuals that is very painful. I can think of a few categories of individuals that Mother's Day weekend is often very painful, and I want to challenge us to also reach out for these individuals as well. One, there are some individuals whose mothers are not like the kind that I just described. And if that is the case, Mother's Day is a reminder of the pain and hurt from not having a mother who was there when you needed them most. Secondly, there are individuals who might have had an awesome mother, but they passed away. And I know for so many, this is a painful reminder that their mother has passed. And third, there are some individuals who want to be mothers Maybe they've lost a child or something has happened, or maybe they're just not able to be to get pregnant or what have you. And so this is often a very painful time of the year. If you know of individuals, you have friends in those kinds of categories, or you know some individuals like that, I also encourage you to reach out to them during this time, during this season, because while this might be a great celebration weekend, this could also be a very painful weekend. And I believe as believers, we can celebrate together and encourage each other and appreciate. But it's also good to mourn with each other, as well as reach out in support and encouragement when others are down. Having said that, the Beth-El church family also knows that this is also in some ways a bittersweet weekend for me, as this is my last Sabbath here with the Beth-El family in Jersey City, New Jersey. And I can't say thank you enough to this awesome family for allowing me to be a pastor through this pandemic. I've been here mostly during the pandemic. I was the interim pastor since July, and I have greatly enjoyed and appreciated the opportunity to serve in this capacity over the last couple months. And in a short while, the new pastor for the Beth-El Seventh Adventist Church will be here. Good friend of mine, buddy of mine, and I can't say enough good things about him. I know that Dr. Jenkins will be an awesome leader. He's a great man of God and a very good friend of mine. And so I'm excited for his soon to begin tenure here at the Beth-El Church. And so in light of this kind of transition, the Lord put a short word on my heart to share about transitions. And it comes from the book of Joshua, and if I can just share just a few verses from Joshua chapter one, beginning at verse one. In fact, before we get into the message today, can we bow our heads for a word of prayer? Our Father in heaven, thank you so much for the opportunity to spend a few moments in your word. Lord, we ask that you would speak to us right now. Speak to our hearts, Lord, speak to our minds, and direct us, Lord, in your word to what we need to hear for our life, for our church at this moment. Lord, for each and every person who might be watching this online, Lord, we pray that this word would be a relevant word to their experience. And though it is about a transition and leadership transitions, Lord, the reality is that you have a word to speak to each and every one of us. And so, Lord, we give you permission to speak. We're listening. May Jesus and Jesus alone be lifted up. In his name we pray. Amen. Joshua chapter 1, beginning at verse 1, and I'm reading from the New Living Translation of the Bible. After the death of Moses, the Lord's servant, the Lord spoke to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' assistant. He said, "Moses, my servant, is dead. Therefore, the time has come for you to lead these people, the Israelites, across the Jordan River into the land I am giving them. I promise you what I promised Moses. Wherever you set foot, you will be on land I have given you, from the Negev wilderness in the south to the Lebanon mountains in the north, from the Euphrates River in the east to the Mediterranean Sea in the west, including all the land of the Hittites. No one will be able to stand against you as long as you live, for I will be with you as I was with Moses. I will not fail you or abandon you. Be strong and courageous, for you are the one who will lead these people to possess all the land I swore to their ancestors I would give them. Be strong and very courageous." Notice God says that twice, like God is repeating himself. It must be important. "Be strong and very courageous." Verse 7, "Be careful to obey all the instructions Moses gave you. Do not deviate from them, turning either to the right or to the left. Then you will be successful in everything you do. Study this book of instruction continually. Meditate on it day and night so you'll be sure to obey everything written in it. Only then will you prosper and succeed in all you do. This is my command. There it is one more time. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Just a few thoughts from this passage, and we clearly see God has said multiple times, be strong and courageous. Don't be afraid. Be strong and courageous. Be strong and courageous. God is speaking to this young congregation, this very large congregation, the Israelites, at a very significant time in their history. Moses, the only leader that they have known after having been in enslavement for over 400 years, many individuals were born and raised and died while still a slave in Egypt. The only life they knew was that of a slave under the whip of the Egyptian slave masters. And then along comes a man named Moses, who's in some ways foreign to them, because Moses speaks, the way of the Egyptians. He's enculturated with the way of the Egyptians. For all intents and purposes, he's Egyptian to them. And so in some ways, he's an outsider. But at the same time, Moses is an insider because he is an Israelite. And Moses is the only leader they have known for over 40 years. They've wandered in the wilderness. They have wandered with no food and wandered with no water and wondered how they would succeed, how they would make it, how they would be successful. How could they ever get into the promised land? And Moses, that's the one they look to, not so much God, although I guess one could say it was God. But when they had no food, they didn't come crying to God. They came crying to Moses. Moses, did you lead us out here to die of starvation in the wilderness? How much better it was for us when we were in Egypt. Moses, are you leading us out here to die of dehydration in the wilderness? We have no water to drink. Moses, don't you see these snakes out in the wilderness? Poisonous snakes, Moses, what are you going to do about it? Moses, don't you see all of the enemies around us? How are you going to protect us? Moses, we don't have food. Moses, we don't have this. We don't have that. How are we going to make it? How are we going to be successful? And it gets so bad that Moses' father-in-law tells him, you got to set up some system so that other people can hear the problems of the people. You're going to burn yourself out listening to everyone's problems all the time. For 40 years, Moses is the singular leader of Israel. He handles all of their problems, solves all of their problems. He fixes all that is broken. Moses is their everything. And after 40 years of faithful leadership, having made a handful of minimal mistakes and one big one that cost him entering into the promised land, the Bible says Moses is dead. What an epitaph. And God says, Joshua, you're the next man up. Y'all know I'm a big sports fan, and that's a common sports phrase. When a superstar gets injured, you know, people start to get worried. What are we going to do? How are we going to win? Next man up. So God comes to Joshua and says, Joshua, Moses' tenure is over. It's your turn. And you can imagine in this setting, in this moment, there's plenty of reason to be afraid, because while they have gone through what obviously would be the heavy lifting, overthrowing Egypt and this great empire and wandering in the wilderness, now they're on the brink of the promised land. But remember, even though Joshua and Caleb gave a good report, the other spies that came back had a bad report and said, we look like grasshoppers compared to the people in the promised land in Canaan. In other words, there's no way we're going to beat them. And it is against this formidable foe, or these formidable foes, that Joshua is now called to lead Israel up against, knowing that the people don't even believe in themselves. And God says, don't worry about Joshua. No need to be afraid. Don't be scared. Don't be worried. Be strong. Be courageous. You're going to be victorious. And I think it is very significant to acknowledge and recognize that success is not determined by the individual leader. That's pretty obvious from the passage. That after 40 years of amazing leadership, God in no way, shape, or form indicates that there's going to be a drop-off for Israel because Moses is gone. And the reason should be obvious, and that is, and here it is, in the transitions of leadership, what God is communicating in the passage is that the reason there's no drop-off nor need to fear or worry, there's the reason you can be strong and courageous and not be afraid is because the real leader has not left yet. He's still on the throne. He's still in charge. The real leader is the one who led them through the wilderness by a pillar of cloud and pillar of fire. It wasn't Moses. Moses had a staff. He had a stick. But the real leader was God Almighty. God is the one who led them against the Egyptian slave masters, and overthrew Pharaoh by his mighty hand and outstretched arm. It was God who brought upon the Egyptian empire those 10 magnificent plagues that eventually overthrew their power and set the captives free. It was God who brought water from the rock, and God who brought manna from the that rose like the dew on the ground. It was God who gave them quail to eat. It was God who protected them from the hands of their enemies every time they went and did battle. It was never Moses who was in charge. It was always God. So when Moses is removed, God says, be strong and courageous. Why? Because there is not a change of leadership. The same one who was in charge leading you out of Egypt is the same one who's in charge who's going to get you into the promised land. And so, brothers and sisters, when there's this seeming transition, and there may be some who say, oh man, I liked so-and-so. In the Israelites' case, I liked Moses. Yeah. Yeah. There's personal affinity. There's preference. There's a connection with one's personality. But the reality is that, and God is trying to make this point pretty clear, that the human leaders are never permanent. Never permanent. That leaders, unfortunately, come and go. But God is still and always has been in charge. And no matter how much we loved or loathed the leader, God's reminder is that because God is in charge and God is on the throne, success can be assured regardless who's the human occupying the position. Now, God makes this point upon Moses' death, but notice what God says to Joshua. He starts to run down the list of the locations that will be theirs. And he says that it will be theirs based on, first of all, his promise. It says, Joshua, you're going to have all the land from the Mediterranean to the Negev and so forth. So you, all of this land is yours. And God is saying it based on, first of all, a promise. And here's the thing about God's promise. God has such a long memory. This promise is not a promise that was made 2 years ago, 20 years ago, 50 years ago. God makes a promise to Abraham. God makes a promise 700 years earlier. And even though generations have come and gone, it is still in the mind of God, the promise that God has made. And here's the thing. When God makes the promise, God then formulates the plan and puts in place his purposes so that regardless of human leaders, God will still accomplish what God has promised based on God's purposes. Brothers and sisters, I have learned that unfortunately many of us live our lives too much in the present. And you got to live in the present. You can't live in the past. Amen. And you can't live in the future. You don't know what the future is going to hold. But unfortunately, sometimes we live too much in the present. What I mean by that is that we forget that our present is a small part of a very large plan and purposes of Almighty God. And not just Almighty God, but even if you think in terms of your own life and family history, it is a part of a small fabric of your own family and its history. In other words, sometimes we get caught up in the right now and we don't take a longer approach to what we're dealing with. Let me give just a simple example. You know, there are unfortunately too many individuals who have invested money, for example, and then lose lots and lots of money. And then in that immediate moment, they take their life because of the moment. But the reality is that the same way you made over 5 years, 10 years, whatever, lots and lots of money, yes, you might lose it. But the reality is that if you take a longer look and approach to life, you realize that, yes, money might have been lost right now and over a short period of time. But you know what? A whole bunch of money was made over the last 10 years. In other words, look at life in a bigger, longer approach, not just in the immediate, not just in the right now. Right now, we might be in a pandemic or slightly coming out of a pandemic, but this is not all of the story. There's a lot more to the story of America, of the world, and of your own life. There's a lot more than just shutdowns and school closures and sicknesses and unfortunately death. There's a lot more than vaccinations and all of this. There's a lot more to our political spectrum than just the crazies on the right and on the left. There's a lot more to the race relations than just George Floyd and Derek Chauvin and the Black Lives Matter movement. This isn't the first, nor will it be the last movement about civil rights and equal rights. This is not the Me Too movement is not the beginning, nor will it be the end of rights, of greater rights for women. There's a whole lot more to our story than where we are right now. And because our story is bigger and longer and larger and more robust than where we are right now, then we have to fit our life in the purposes that are happening now, but on the bigger picture. In other words, we are just one small part of a much bigger picture. Don't lose sight of the big picture. God never loses sight of the big picture. And as much as God loved working with Moses and having Moses as the leader of Israel and leading the children of Israel from Egyptian slavery and out of bondage and into the wilderness and on the brink of the promised land, God understood that Moses was one in a long string of leaders that he would have for Israel. But God made a promise 700 plus years earlier, and God was going to fulfill his word. All the while unfortunately suffering was transpiring and death was transpiring, God never lost sight of his promise nor of his purpose. It reminds me of what Dr. King once said when he said that the arc of the moral universe is long, but it bends toward justice. The idea of saying it's long, he was reminding us that we take small steps towards equality, small steps towards equal rights, small steps towards a greater and more perfect union, small steps towards racial harmony, small steps towards being a better church, a more loving people, a better family, economic empowerment, commitment. Whatever you're talking about, whatever the conversation, we make these steps, but it is always a part of a very long journey. It's not the end. It's not the beginning. We're always somewhere in the middle. And God never loses sight of his purposes. And so God can say to Joshua, hey, Joshua, I know you loved Moses. He was such a great leader of Israel. But he's gone. And the people are on the brink of the promised land. And I made a promise that I'm going to get them into the promised land and give them all the land of Canaan. So now you're up and you're going to move the people to the next level to accomplish my purposes based on my promise. Brothers and sisters, please don't ever lose sight of the big picture of what God is doing in this world. Sometimes life becomes monotonous. Sometimes it seems like we're going nowhere. Sometimes it seems like there's other people are making more progress than we, or things aren't going the way that we'd like it to go. But never forget, God has a big picture. And sometimes the story moves slowly. Sometimes it moves rapidly. But God is calling on us to do our part based on God's purposes and God's promise. That's why transitions happen. Bible says one man sows, another man waters. God is the one who brings growth, and God is the one who gets the glory. It's never about the leader. It's not even about us, the people of God. It's about the purposes and the promise of God. And God is always going to fulfill his word. Which leads to the second thing that God says to Joshua, why he knows he's going to be successful, not only because God has made a promise. He's made a promise, and it's based on his purposes. He made a promise long time ago, and God is going to fulfill his promise, and God has a very long memory. And so in spite of the fact that we might have forgotten, Israelites might have forgotten all them years while they were enslaved, they had forgotten perhaps what God had promised. God never forgets. God always remembers. If he says it, God is going to do it. He's a man of his word. But the second thing, why God can assure Joshua of success, God says, because success is not going to be based on you. It's based on me and my presence. And that is key. God says, yes, there's a transition in leadership, but my presence is constant. It says I was with Moses. And just like I was with Moses, I'm going to be with you. In other words, leaders come and go and members come and go, but God's presence is constant. And because God's presence is constant, that we have the guarantee that what his presence accomplished before, his presence can accomplish again, even with different leadership, human leadership. God says, my presence is going to be with you, just like it was with Moses. In other words, God is saying that there is a consistency in spite of all of the change that happens over time. There are some things that are consistent, and my presence is one of them. My promises is another thing. And as long as I made a promise, I will keep my word. And to keep my word, I promise I will not leave you nor forsake you. Joshua, you don't have to be afraid. You don't know what the future holds, Joshua, but no need to be scared. No need to be worried. No need to be afraid. I'm going to be with you just like I was with Moses. No one is going to be able to stand up against you just like they couldn't stand up against Moses. Why? Because my presence was with you. Your success is not going to be dependent on how strong and mighty and how smart and eloquent and how creative and ingenious you are. It will be based on my presence. And so he says, he warns, don't do anything to spurn my presence. In other words, he says, here's the words that Moses left you. Make sure you obey them. Why? Not because there's salvation in obedience. No, you make sure you obey the word because you don't want to turn my presence away. You don't want to push me out because your success is dependent on my presence. So here's the word. Make sure you follow the word. Be constant be consistent in following the word. Why? So that you can appreciate my presence. God says, just like I was with Moses, I will be with you, Joshua. And the reality is that God is always, God is always in the transitions. If you don't learn the lessons that God wants to teach in the transitions, then unfortunately, we might end up like the children of Israel wandering in a circle for 40 years until we learn the lesson. God's still going to keep his word. It might take longer, but God's going to keep his word. But there's always lessons in the transition. Beth-El, let me say very specifically, and I think I got this line correct, that over the last several years, there have been a number of different pastors with different kind of leadership style and directions. I believe there was a Pastor Norman. That's who was Pastor Beth-El when I first became a pastor in Allegheny East Conference. And then you had, Pastor Janie, Pastor Hines, Pastor Levy, Pastor Eli. I have served as interim. You will have Pastor Jenkins. And with all of the different leaders, God has not left his church. There are lessons to learn through each. But God is the one who has been the constant through all of the transitions. His presence has not left us. God will continue to lead his church if we learn the lessons and appreciate his presence. There's a third thing that Joshua 1 reminds us. It's not only that Joshua will be successful because of God's promise, because God remembers the promise he made many years earlier. It's not only that Joshua will be successful because of God's presence, but God makes it very clear that Joshua will be successful because of God's power. His success is depending on his reliance on Almighty God. To the degree that he relies on God, that will be how powerful he will be and the Israelites will be. When they rely on themselves, like the battle of Ai, when they rely on themselves, they'll lose. But as long as they rely on God, to the degree that they rely on God, they will have success. Brothers and sisters, our success in life, in church, in whatever we do, is based on our reliance on Almighty God, not on the people that are placed in positions of power. Yes, they have an influence, absolutely. But our success will always be dependent primarily on our reliance on Almighty God. And that becomes evidenced in our prayer life. Because when the people of God pray, and not just take into account the immediate prayers, but pray for the bigger picture and the purposes of God, and pray earnestly that God's will be done on earth as it is in heaven, we see God move in amazing ways. And he can do it regardless of who's in what position. God doesn't need a specific person in the position of elder in order for someone who's a member of Beth-El to be praying and you see healing happen. Doesn't matter who's the elder. God can still work a miracle through the prayers of the righteous. Doesn't matter who's the pastor, God can still transform the hearts and lives of individuals in the city of Jersey City. He can still transform the city and turn it upside down. Doesn't matter who's the pastor. But will the people of God be faithful and consistent in prayer, regardless of the transitions? Because our success will be dependent on our reliance on Almighty God. My desire for Bethel is that, yes, there's a new pastor coming, and I pray and hope that he gets all the support and love and appreciation and all the prayers and calls, and I hope he gets all of that and some that I received. I cannot say enough about how awesome it has been to serve at Bethel, even though it has only been during a pandemic. I can't tell you how awesome it has been. Just wonderful, wonderful individuals, fantastic congregation. And I hope that Dr. Jenkins has that experience and more. From working with, I hope he gets to see all of the creativity, all of the great ideas, outreach, the hardworking members. I hope he gets to see all of that. My greatest desire is that when it is all said and done, that Bethel has, as a congregation, a slew of individuals from the city of Jersey City that may never know the names of the pastors as I rattled them off, but individuals who say, I don't know Pastor so-and-so, I don't know but I do know Sister so-and-so who prayed for me when I was sick or my loved one was sick and wrought healing to my body. I do know Brother so-and-so when I was down and out, and they walked with me through my difficulties and supported me until I could get back on my feet. I do know Sister so-and-so who listened to me as I was crying out in agony and pain and heartache of the tragedies that have gone on in my life, and they walked with me through that, helped me get back on my feet. That's my desire for Bethel, that the people of God will do what the people of God are called to do. Through the transitions, through all of the different leadership styles and personality types, that the people of God will be consistent because you're looking at the bigger picture, the purposes of God and the promises of God. And it's not just about the immediate difficulties or challenges or how much I love this guy or don't like that one. I hope we can rise beyond all of that because God has a big plan that includes each and every one of us. And that plan is going to be fulfilled with or without us. My desire is that we'll be a part of the purposes of Almighty God. I'm going to leave you with something that I say this at every congregation I've ever pastored on my last day. In my family, I don't know exactly when it started, but when my son was very young, when he would, we always kissed our kids good night. And my son started to say something that we continued, and it became the thing that we'd say in our family every night before bed. It was three phrases. Good night, I love you, and I'll see you in the morning. And we would kiss, embrace, say good night, I love you, I'll see you in the morning. Bethel, I'm not going to be able to embrace each and every one of you, but I have thoroughly enjoyed the last couple of months, of which you probably won't know how blessed I feel to have been able to serve until we get into the kingdom. I'm not going to say good night because this isn't good night. But I am leaving, and so I'm saying farewell until the Lord returns and until we can all be reunited forever in the kingdom of God. I love you, and I can't wait to see you in that great getting up morning. God bless you. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, thank you so much for your word. And Lord, even though sometimes transitions are hard, Lord, you make it easier because your presence is constant. You will never leave us nor forsake us. And we know that one day soon there's a reunion that will come. And we will be forever reunited, not only with each other, with loved ones that we have lost, with believers throughout the ages, but most of all, we'll be reunited with our Lord and Savior, and we'll be able to spend forever with you. Until then, keep us faithful to you. Keep us faithful to your word, to the mission in front of us, until you come. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen. God bless you. On the video, there'll be various ways, if you are a visitor or unfamiliar with our church, various ways you can give if you should so choose to support this ministry financially. Most of all, we want you to support this ministry with your prayers and with your presence. As the country is more and more opening up, there's more and more opportunity to serve and to be of service and ministry in Jersey City and in the surrounding areas. And so we want to encourage you to do so. But if you'd like to give financially, there are various ways that you can do that, and they are listed on the screen. So we encourage you to be generous in your gifts. God bless you. Have an awesome rest of your week.
Farewell, Pastor. We'll continue to pray for you during your future endeavors.
Oh, we are going up.
We are going up.
We're going up together.
We're going up together.
We're going up to conquer. Going up to conquer
in the name of the Lord.
Oh, so don't talk.
No, no.
Oh, don't talk defeat to me.
Don't talk defeat to me.
Cause I'm a child of God.
Child of God.